In 1941, the British Empire may have been past its apogee, but its sun had by no means set. After the war, the Labour government would commence its dismantlement, but until then, and throughout the fighting, the British would continue to rule over vast swathes of the globe. And there were few territories where the colonial life was lived more splendidly than in Kenya, as it was then known, one of the brightest jewels in the imperial crown. As the World War raged, Nairobi Clubland danced on. You'd never have known that its most dazzling member, the handsome Earl of Errol, was about to spend his last night on Earth.
Will you still be awake at 3? I'm free then if it's not too late. Yes. Goodbye.
Another date in the busy life of a feral cat. You might at least finish dinner with one woman before making assignation with another.
I think we are finished. Nobody wanted pudding. Don't jump to conclusions, Gladys. How do you know it wasn't war work?
8 o'clock, Joss.
I know.
Have fun.
Let's go.
In the small hours of the 24th of January, 1941, Jocelyn Victor Hay, 22nd Earl of Errol and Hereditary Lord High Constable of Scotland, was shot dead on the Nairobi Ngong Road. He had lived largely for pleasure, in its infinite variety, at the centre of the famous Happy Valley set, a one-man model for the waggish joke, "Are you married or do you live in Kenya?" All in all, it was not perhaps a complete surprise that Lord Errol had been found murdered with a bullet in his brain. Even during a war, when an English baronet is on trial for the murder of a Scottish earl, it makes headlines. Press and public lapped it up, relishing every salacious detail of life in Happy Valley. With Errol's reputation, there were many angry husbands with scores to settle, but the police arrested the most recent, Sir Jock Delvis Broughton, 11th Baronet of Doddington in Cheshire. There were plenty of people then and later who suspected Jock's wife, Diana. She'd been Errol's mistress, and she had intended to marry him. Had the plan misfired? Then Hugh Dickinson, Diana's former love, Hughesy Daisy, had been secure in her affections until Errol arrived. Gladys Delamere was almost unique in Kenya at that time in that she was not one of Errol's mistresses, but oh, how she wished she'd been. Then again, there was a war on. Errol was a key figure in the resistance to the Nazi advance. Was this a political assassination disguised as a lover's revenge? At last, despite police rigour and a skilled prosecution team, Broughton was acquitted, although quite why was then, and remains, a mystery. Of course, the story had everything. High class, low morals. But for all the curiosity the scandal excited, no one ever did resolve quite what happened on that hot African night in wartime. Joss Errol was born with every gift save one, an ancient title, film star looks, he even had brains. But he lacked money. His family had run dry and his grandfather had been forced to sell their seat, Slane's Castle. Still, Joss retained an aristocratic sense of duty, and when war broke out, he accepted the role of military secretary for East Africa. It was important work. Using the German and Italian colonies, the Nazis meant to strike at the British through their African territories. But Joss was a good choice. He was clever, and he was fiercely patriotic, both for Britain and for his adopted country, Kenya.
Gladys, did we have a date?
I hear there's been a mutiny.
Oh, really?
In the north.
Well, nobody's told me.
If they had, you wouldn't tell me.
Then why ask?
I wish you'd use me more.
No, you don't. You wish I'd tell you more. Which, of course, I can't.
Gladys was the widow of Lord Delamere, one of the founding fathers of British Kenya, and she adored her new country. Maybe because it freed her from a shady past in England, which included an affair with the former Prince of Wales.
Am I interrupting something?
No. Please come in. Lady Delamere's just leaving.
Of course.
Joss dealt with the War Office through a local agent of British intelligence.
I take it this is about the mutiny.
London wants to know whom we can send up there to settle things.
There's a fellow called Blundell up at Solai, near Nakuru. Coffee farmer and cattle rancher. He speaks their language. He's the man they want.
When could be...
He's on his way there now.
Very impressive.
Well, if I waited for orders from London every time, we'd have been over a month ago.
So, what can we give you as a reward?
I'm sure I'll think of something.
Many settlers came to Kenya, and no wonder. It was a beautiful place. And a respectable income could still secure a way of life which, after 1914, was increasingly becoming the preserve of only the very rich back home. Their headquarters was the Muthega Club, first port of call for noble visitor and arrivist alike.
It's too funny. They think we're going to share a room.
Well, don't worry, darling, I'll sort it out. Why don't you go and sit down?
John Rawdon's first wife had run off with Diana Mitford's ex, Lord Moyne. And in 1940, to soothe his aching heart, he married the undoubtedly lovely, socially rather dubious Diana Caldwell. His friends were sceptical. So was Diana, but she wanted to spend the war in Kenya, and in those male-dominated days, a single woman was never given an entry permit.
All settled.
Allow me.
Thank you.
Pleasure. You'll be staying a while, eh?
What's Wilkie got to?
She's helping with the rest of the luggage.
I do wish she wouldn't run off like that.
Well, do you want to come upstairs, start unpacking?
Don't be silly, I can't unpack without my maid.
Diana Broughton was the daughter of a successful garage owner.
That's very kind, thank you.
My pleasure.
Diana!
Daisy, darling.
When did you arrive?
What? Now, literally. That's our luggage.
Fabulous.
Come on.
She was clearly quite adaptable to new surroundings, and she took to the ways of Happy Valley like a duck to water.
Proper soap. What a treat. God, I'm glad to be out of England.
Must have been terrified.
Oh, I could manage the bombing. It was the tax on stockings that nearly finished me off.
You could also come out here earlier. I'd have married you.
You're already married.
Well, I'd have got a divorce.
That'd have been lovely. So tiresome of you not to be rich. It's quite legal. They'll let me go if I want to marry someone else. And when I leave, he'll give me an allowance for 5 years.
How on earth did you get him to sign it?
Oh, you know me, darling. I have my little ways.
Diana was managing a cocktail club in Mayfair when she started her affair with Hugh Dickinson. She called him Hughesy Daisy, and he seems to have been as soppy as his nickname where she was concerned. In 1941, he was in the Signal Corps. And when he heard she was coming to Kenya, he arranged for a transfer to be near her. But if he did love Diana, he was never more than a plaything for her. As for the agreement with Broughton, Diana seems to have been oddly blind as to Jock's motives for signing it. Was it likely he would honour such a contract without a struggle?
No, are you here for the war?
I'm not sure yet. It rather depends upon Diana, my new wife.
I didn't know that you and Vera were divorced.
Well, only just. Diana and I were married in Durban last month. Oh, here she is. Darling, I'd love you to meet Jack Soames. He's an old school friend of mine.
Pardon, dears. Where are the honeymooners?
Lady Delamere, mayoress of Nairobi. You'll have to meet her.
Will I? Oh, golly.
Where did you and Jock meet?
In a bar. He was drunk, and I was dancing with another man. Fancy.
Has the war affected life much, eh?
Well, you won't get away from it, if that's what you mean. Contrary to what people think back home, we do our bit. Joss is being simply marvellous. I only hope they appreciate him back in London.
Who's Joss?
Lord Errol. Jock knows him.
I think you met him, darling, when we first arrived. Didn't he help Wilkie with the baggage?
Oh, him. Oh, so that's Joss Errol.
And I must say, I'm rather surprised that he's a war hero. I had him down as a playboy when I was here last.
That was in the Happy Valley days. He's a reformed character now.
He's the truest friend of Kenya you could wish to find.
Diana!
Oh, no.
June! You got home all right?
You've met them.
We came over on the same aeroplane.
Stop gassing. I'm hungry.
Oh, don't be rude, JC. I'll see you in a minute.
Isn't it funny how these people find each other?
Well, I think we are going into...
I'm having some people up country next weekend. Why don't you bring Diana?
Well, I think we'd love to, wouldn't we, darling?
That'd be lovely.
Yes. Don't come too close, darling.
Shall we stop?
Can I have a go?
Allow me. You're to line up this with that.
Beginner's luck.
Didn't know you could shoot, darling.
Girl can't tell all her secrets.
Oh, look out, everyone. Oh, oh.
Especially you, darling.
Give me the bloody stuff.
Oh, what's the matter, darling? Can't you take a joke? Please, God, we don't have to go and live on one of the farms. I've never been so bored in my life.
I'm sure you'd keep yourself entertained, milady.
Darling, would you mind terribly if I didn't come this evening? It's just that I have to look at some property that we might rent. And to tell you the truth, I don't awfully feel like it. Wouldn't wreck it for you, would it?
Not a bit. I'll make Husey-Daisy take me.
I do wish you wouldn't call him that.
I don't think he answers to anything else.
War clouds engulfed Europe. The Axis powers were closing in on Africa. But dinner was still served at the Muthega Club.
What's Lord Errol really like?
Don't start. Your life is complicated enough.
Oh, I don't know.
You don't mind, do you, boy?
Of course he doesn't.
Joss is up to his usual tricks, I see. And he doesn't seem to be encountering much opposition.
Do you know Lady Broughton?
No. I can't help but think that poor old Jock has got his hands full.
Lucky him.
Gladys is looking daggers. Better ask her to dance or she'll never forgive me.
Oh, I don't think so. She might get ideas of frustration.
Stop it! Don't you dare! Should we do something?
No, that's their way.
You all right?
Oh, don't worry.
worry about it. All part of the service.
He always looks so angry.
He is angry. He's furious. And I never know why. He gave up his title, you know. He's really Lord Carberry. When I asked him the reason he'd done it, he knocked me flat. I suppose he was messed up in his childhood. We all were.
Why do you let him hit you?
You may as well ask why I married him.
Well, why did you?
Don't know, really. Seemed a good idea at the time. I was his third wife. Everyone told me I was completely mad.
And what happened to the other two?
One divorced him, the other went down in a plane. I'm next. It's called living dangerously, and you should know all about that. Joss has got more scalps than Hiawatha. I hope you know what you're doing. Well, don't say you haven't been warned.
Why is it all men like common tarts?
You dance very well.
Thank you.
I imagine you're good at all sorts of things.
I try to keep myself in training.
Divorced from his first wife, Edina, his second, Molly, dead from drugs, Joss was a strange dichotomy. Intelligent, patriotic, hard-working, and yet devoid of sexual morality and addicted to living on the edge.
You. Oh, is she?
Yes, I was just talking to her.
Oh, I've got some good news.
Really? What?
I've managed to rent a house, and I think Diana's going to love it.
Oh. Oh, look. Here she comes now.
Hello, darling.
Hello, darling. Oh, now, Errol, I'm glad I caught you. I understand you're running the war effort. Now, I'd like to help, but I don't know how.
Well, why don't you come over tomorrow? We'll sort something out.
The game, Lady Broughton. Oh, lovely.
Do you play billiards? I didn't know that, darling.
Oh, she's very good.
Excuse me.
Lovely house, Diana.
Please just come back for the rest, would you?
Isn't it splendid?
That time, come on, then.
What's Joe going to say when he finds out?
Wilkie, you're muddling up summer and winter. Can you take all that out and start again?
Poor old Joe. I think he's rather sweet.
You can have him if you want him. Wilkie, have you found the coat that goes with that?
Not yet, milady, but it'll turn up.
I thought we might put Husey Daisy in the guest house.
Why not? You need someone to run your errands.
Haile Selassie has been begging the League of Nations to help, but Mussolini won't want to give up Ethiopia. Not after shedding all that good Italian blood to get it.
Does that affect us?
Well, it will do. Ethiopia is going to be the axis on which the North African campaign turns. What did you do in the last war? I know you were invalided out.
How did you hear that?
I think Gladys told me.
Yes, well, I was rather unlucky. My leg still plays me up somewhat.
Well, Keene is a good place to make a new start.
That's what I thought.
Harrow was right. The fight for the throne of Ethiopia was a vital part of the Nazi plan to subvert Africa. In fact, my own father was in a small and secret group given the task of saving it for the Emperor Haile Selassie. A Nazi-Italian victory would have posed a real threat to British Kenya, and Errol himself would certainly have been a target for the enemy. As for Broughton and his record in the First War, well, far from being unlucky, it was almost incredibly lucky, as he collapsed with sunstroke on the eve of an engagement in which most of his unit died. It wasn't his fault, of course, but he carried the guilt of it for the rest of his life.
Well, actually, I got the impression he thought I might be rather useful. I think there's much more to him than some people think.
Well, you don't have to convince me.
Poor old Jock. There's enough with anybody to give him a kind word and a pat.
I think it's rather lovely.
Do you? I think it's rather pathetic.
Diana, what a lovely frock.
Thank you.
Isn't it marvellous how fashions come round and round?
Oh, you mustn't mind me. I'm just an old country bumpkin these days.
Tell me, how long have you been in Kenya?
Oh, Gladys arrived with the Founding Fathers, cutting her way in from the coast, didn't you, dear?
Not quite. I came out in 28.
Yes, before anybody.
Except me. Happy birthday.
What? Whose birthday is it?
Mine.
Good show, Jos.
Why didn't you tell us? Never tell anyone.
Would you care to dance?
Right.
Would you like to dance?
Oh, no. Thank you, my leg.
Just someone I work with.
Oh.
Who's from the War Office?
How did you know it was my birthday?
I know everything. I was rather looking forward to celebrating properly, alone.
Alone, eh? Might be your lucky night.
Come on, Gladys. Let's get you home.
I can manage.
Good night. See you very soon.
Good night to you both.
I've just persuaded Diana to come and stay the night with me at Nairobi. You don't mind, do you? Only I do get a bit spooked when JC's away, and I would love it.
Well, what about your clothes and things?
Well, I can borrow the night things from June, and Wilkie can bring something over in the morning. Well, I won't if you'd rather I didn't.
Oh, no. Of course not. You must go. Would you like to take the car? Send it back for me.
No need. I've got ours. Good night, Poppet.
Oh, yes.
Sleep tight.
Good night.
See you tomorrow.
Yes. Suppose I didn't know you were here.
Good night, Jock.
If Jock was in denial about the affair, this comfort was destroyed by an anonymous letter sent to his home by a member of the club. The author was determined that Broughton should acknowledge the scandal going on under his nose. It accused him of cowardice.
What are you going to do about it? Of course, such a letter, well, such a situation was not in itself unknown in the colony, especially in Happy Valley. It might have been malicious slander from some bored troublemaker. Except, of course, the allegations were true.
They show us no respect for the effort that we make. Anyone would think that all we ever do is sit around the pool sipping cocktail.
Which is more or less right, in some cases.
When I think of what my Kenya has got...
It isn't your bloody Kenya, Gladys. The whole bloody world isn't about you.
Really, June, I don't know how you can bear him.
I must have got used to it.
And she's drunk most of the time, anyway.
Stone that, John.
Keep out of it, Millsop.
Darling.
Face it, Gladys. London doesn't care about us. London doesn't care about anything but London. The plain truth is the crowds think we're far more important than the boys back home.
How much more of this do we have to listen to?
To as much as I say. And I say this. To hell with England. Long live Germany.
God, John, please.
Get out of it.
Oh. I think you should leave right now.
Here, here.
Ooh, so those two could go upstairs and go at it like rabbits. Even the milk boys in my area are talking about it.
I'll get some anarcho.
Well, I'll say one thing for him. At least he's never dull.
Frightfully brave with Husey Daisy. What happens if that ghastly man doesn't get out of the car when they get there?
Poor Husey Daisy. How he must hate you. Are you in love with her?
You don't like her, do you?
Haven't decided.
Liar.
Well, the point is, what are you going to do about it?
About what?
Are you going to marry her? I just think you're being very unfair on Jock.
Is that what's bothering you? I'm off. I'm going to go and say goodbye to Jock.
I don't know why you stay with him. I don't really understand why you married him in the first place.
You sound like my mother. He was a challenge, I suppose.
Oh, what is it about people like us? Why can't we settle for somebody kind and pleasant, somebody who wants to share our lives, enjoy our company?
Here's to better luck next time.
I'm in hell, June. I can't take this much longer.
You've got to. And that's all there is to it.
JC's gone. Husey Daisy took him home.
Oh, thank God for that. And Joss?
He's gone too. I hope you understand how very special he is.
Do stop trying to control everything.
Diana?
Aunt, I have got to get out of this marriage.
Will you be all right on your own?
Of course I will. I thought you went ages ago.
No, I got, away late.
I should go.
How are you getting home?
Jock's driver is taking me.
Ah, you ready?
Joss is taking June home, so I thought I'd better go with her. Keep her company just for the night.
You don't mind, do you?
Not at all. You have all the time.
Thank you,
Joss and Diana were pursuing their affair with an indiscretion that would not have been permitted at home. Knowingly or not, they put Jock Broughton under hideous pressure.
I do love her, you know.
I'm sure you do, old chap.
I don't know what the hell I'm going to do.
Ask Errol if he intends to marry her. If he does, Then I'm afraid you're going to have to keep your promise and let her go without a fuss. That if he doesn't, tell him to get lost and take Diana away for a while to get over it. Here. This will help you sleep.
Thank you.
Hot.
Your neck is too bare.
Too bare for what?
Sit up.
Whose are they?
They're yours.
Whose were they?
Molly's.
Everyone will ask where they came from.
Then tell them.
Oh, Joss, are you sure?
Of course I'm sure. Pearls are no good in a bank. Anyway, they lose their luster if they're not worn.
Then I'll never take them off.
But if Diana was starting to dream of a larger future with her lover, it was around this time that Broughton, in modern parlance, was losing it. The trouble was that clearly he'd signed the release agreement in an effort to persuade Diana to marry him, but the last thing on earth he wanted was to abide by it. And in fact, it was naive of Diana, something she wasn't generally accused of, to think that he would. To make matters worse, Broughton was taking huge doses of Mednol washed down with liberal draughts of alcohol. It was an explosive mix.
Did you ever see them on Molly?
I did. And they didn't look as well on her.
What are you going to tell Jock?
I have a good mind to tell him the truth.
I wouldn't tell you. Not unless you're quite sure of Joss.
Just have to say I've come from an aunt or something. We should be off. We're meeting Husey Daisy at the club.
Well, I'll join you since I've changed.
What's going to happen?
You know me. I'll be all right.
She doesn't look unhappy, does she?
Just remember, Joss only marries heiresses. If you sit tight, it'll all blow over, I'm sure.
You know Errol hasn't a bean.
So I gather.
You always told me you'd never marry a man with no money.
I've changed. People do.
I haven't changed.
Oh, darling. I know if I had any sense, it would have been you. But I'm afraid I haven't.
Actually, there's something I feel I should have told you.
Your husband's not all he appears to be. Did you know he tried to break the entail on Doddington?
He tried to sell off the estate.
When?
A couple of years ago. They wouldn't let him. He's flat broke, Diana.
Why didn't you tell me this before?
Well, I didn't know until after you were married. Then I was posted out here and...
And you thought that we could pick up where we left off?
Perhaps I was angry. It pleased me a bit to think that you'd thrown yourself away on an old, poor man. I'm sorry.
Don't be. You've set me free.
What do you mean?
It helps to know he tricked me. Besides, if I hadn't come to Kenya, I'd never have met Joss Errol.
Diana, might I have a word?
What is it?
I want you to come with me to Ceylon.
What?
Look, I want you to come with me for 3 months. If at the end of that time you still wish to be with Joss, then I'll let you go without a fuss.
Well, you said you'd let me go if I fell for another man, and I have. So let me go. I won't hold you to the money part. You needn't worry about that.
Well, I hope you're pleased with yourself.
I'm sorry.
He's not rich, you know.
I can't imagine what you're talking about.
It's obvious why you've been pushing that common little piece of Joss. Everyone can see it.
What can they see?
That you're after poor old Jock.
Oh!
What are you laughing at?
At you, my dear. At your sad attempt to conceal your jealousy. At your rigid and oh so very unrequited passion for Joss. Forgive me, but it's quite hilarious.
Joss and I have an understanding.
Well, he understands that he has to run whenever he catches sight of you. Is that what you mean? Of course I do see it must be hard to be the only woman in Keeney he doesn't want to sleep with.
How? But we all have our difficulties.
Dare you, you vulgar gin-soaked...
I forgot my hat.
And if you think he believes you and Diana spend all that time at your house as you say you do, you're even more stupid than he is.
Been stolen.
What gun? The one you were holding the other day?
Yes. I think it might have been that one.
Didn't you lock it away?
I must have done, but it's not there now.
Well, hadn't you better report it?
Naturally, a missing firearm must be taken seriously at any time, especially when there's a war on.
And Jock Broughton did indeed report the theft of a handgun to the local police that very day.
Any news from the north?
Not much. Rommel's still setting the pace.
We would have to get Hitler's best general.
Well, still, we've got one thing going for us.
What's that?
Most of his troops are Italian.
I almost forgot. This was left for you at the club. Bad news?
Bad, yes. Not exactly news.
Where is he?
I take it you mean Lord Errol.
Yes, I do. There's no fool like an old fool. Who'd write that to me?
I have no idea.
I will tell him he can have her if that's what he wants. And he's going to have to prove to me that he's going to see it all the way through. She will not become just another one of his women. Get me a line.
That was Jock. He wants to meet me and his lawyers tomorrow.
Did he say why?
Well, imagine we all know why.
Oh, morning, Gladys.
Joss, it's got to stop. You must give her up. It's all going to get extremely unpleasant if you don't call a halt to it now.
Have you taken leave of your senses?
Well, can't you see what she is? She's a social climbing little gold digger.
Well, if she's a gold digger, she's picked very badly.
Joss, I'm serious.
Enough! You tell us all how much you love Kenya. Gladys, we're at war. What the hell does it matter whom I sleep with? Grow up!
Please, sit. I thought I'd tell you that I've booked my passage for Ceylon. I was wondering, do you think we might all have dinner this evening? As a way of marking a resolution of everything, as it were. What do you think?
Why not?
Oh, good. Well, I've already told June. Have you seen Hugh? I think we should all be together, all the principal players.
Hughie's laid up at home. He's done something to his foot.
Dear, what bad luck. I thought I'd leave J.C. out of it. You don't think you mind, do you?
Not half as much as we would if you came.
Well, then.
I have to work this afternoon.
For God's sake, don't be late for dinner.
The word at the club is that you're going to marry her.
I've had worse things said about me.
Are the rumours true?
You're an intelligence, you know what to do with the rumours.
Just, we're on the verge of a major military operation. And I had to spend most of yesterday afternoon dealing with a half-mad, jealous husband.
Yes, rather a bore, I agree.
I'm serious. I thought the Happy Valley days were over. That's why I recommended you.
Look, it's not my fault if Broughton can't control himself.
This is war. And in wartime, nobody's indispensable.
What's going to happen to Wilkie?
The ghastly thing is, I can't afford to keep her.
You mean you have to dress yourself?
It can't be that hard. Millions do. I suppose you don't want her.
Will that be all, m'lady?
Yes, thank you. Poor old Wilkie.
Poor old Jock. I can't imagine why he's having this desperate dinner. He's in such a state.
He'll get over it.
I don't know how you can be so cool.
Don't you?
Well, he's your husband when all is said and done.
Oh, come off it, June. You've helped me and Joss more than anybody, and I know why. Don't start playing the dutiful wife now. It doesn't suit you.
You'll wear those out.
How long do you think you'll be in Ceylon?
I haven't decided yet.
I suppose it's quite safe.
As safe as anywhere else.
I'm not so sure. The Japanese should want to get into it.
If they did, they'd want to support us, not some Austrian decorator with a toothbrush moustache.
I still don't understand why you're going.
I think we all know it's time that I went somewhere. So why not Ceylon? Let's drink to that. To Diana and Joss. I wish you every happiness.
He said we'd look in on the Claremont Roadhouse party later.
Don't bring her back too late.
How late is it too late?
She's tired, Joss. Have her back by 3.
Excuse me. Will you still be awake at 3? I'm free then if it's not too late. Yes. Okay. Goodbye.
Another date in the busy life of a feral cat. You might at least finish dinner with one woman before making an assignation with another.
I think we are finished. Nobody wanted pudding. They jumped to conclusions, Gladys. How do you know it wasn't war work?
Because I know you.
Not as well as you think you do.
3 o'clock, Joss.
I know.
Have fun.
Let's go.
I've decided I'm not going to I'm not going to hold him to the money part of our deal.
What do you mean?
at the divorce. I'm not asking for the allowance. You don't mind too much, do you, darling? We don't need money to be happy, do we? Joss.
I didn't realize we got to that stage.
I don't understand.
Darling, we're at war. There's a big push going on up north tomorrow. Of course, I shouldn't have told you that, but you must see what's at stake here.
I know what's at stake. My life's at stake. My heart is at stake.
Of course, darling, and it matters terribly. But don't you see, we're not important. Not in the great scheme of things. At least, not at the moment. We will be again, please God. But not until everything's settled.
Joss, my husband is leaving me because of you.
You're pretending it was all marvellous until I came along.
I'm not pretending anything. I just want us to be together. I love you. I have never said that and meant it to any other man in my life.
And I'm flattered.
You're flattered.
She's getting £5,000 out of me. She's got another thing coming.
All right, Jock, there's no need to tell the whole world.
I mean, she can go and live with him all she wants, but I'm not going to bloody well pay for it.
Let's go.
No, I want another drink.
No, you don't.
Oh, I want another drink.
Jock!
Woman!
Are you all right?
Well, of course I am. Why shouldn't I be?
Get some sleep and we'll talk about it in the morning.
Good
night. Jock. You know you don't have to be alone if you don't want to be.
That's very kind. But I don't think I can contemplate intimacy with somebody who's betrayed me as you have.
And so the 22nd Earl of Errol was dead. This was one of the government buildings in Nairobi, and there is a theory that Errol was lured to his doom following orders from on high, that he was in fact assassinated.
Just someone I work with. He's from the War Office. Will you still be awake at 3? I'm free then if it's not too late.
Were they afraid that he was becoming indiscreet, endangering delicate operations in Ethiopia? I don't believe he was, because he took his work very seriously. But they might have thought it. Even so, why on earth would they sacrifice their most capable officer? There were plenty of people with a much stronger motive to kill Errol. Was Hugh Dickinson's foot really hurt? Nobody else saw it. Or was he constructing an alibi that would leave him free to revenge himself on the man who had stolen his only love? The marriage to Broughton had posed no real threat to Dickinson. But as Errol's wife, he knew Diana would be lost to him forever. Oh, I'm sure that Hughesy Daisy would have liked Errol dead. I just don't believe he had the balls to kill him. Gladys Delamere was almost definitely the authoress of the anonymous letters.
Well, the point is, what are you going to do about it?
About what?
Are you going to marry her? I just think you're being very unfair on Jock.
Is that what's bothering you?
So, had her jealous rage spilled over into homicidal madness? Gladys didn't pull the trigger. It would have put the war effort at risk. And in the last analysis, she loved Kenya more than she loved any man, even Errol. Which leaves Diana.
I love you. I have never said that and meant it to any other man in my life.
And I'm flattered.
Had she misjudged Errol, and did that send her over the edge? Broughton, June, and Diana all claimed that Errol had dropped her off at 3 as planned, but were they lying? Because the plain fact is, whatever the popular intelligence on the subject, the Earl of Errol had company in that car on the Nairobi Road. If Joss did try to cool things with Diana that night, she wouldn't have taken it easily. And whatever she said in court, she did not go home.
I know this, just as I know what happened afterwards, from an impeccable source that I have no intention of revealing on television or in private. And you are, of course, at liberty not to believe me. But it's true.
I'm afraid there's no doubt. She was lying.
So, was that the answer? So many settlers wanted to believe that Diana was the killer. She could certainly shoot.
You didn't know you could shoot, darling.
Girl can't tell all her secrets.
Above all things, Diana wanted to be Countess of Errol. My parents arrived in Kenya in 1943, a couple of years after the murder. Most of these people were still there. My mother absolutely detested Diana. She thought she was common, if you can still say that, and hard as nails. But even she was convinced that Diana had intended to marry Errol, if only to exchange an old baronet for a young earl. No, I don't think she killed him. Maybe she even loved him. After all, she'd always said she would never marry without money, and she set that aside for Joss.
What's going to happen?
You know me. I'll be all right.
He hasn't a bean.
So I gather.
You always told me you'd never marry a man with no money.
I've changed. People do.
Diana was there, and she saw the murderer. Was it guilt or pity that kept her silent? Because it wasn't Diana who tipped over the edge. The police were right all along.
It was Jock Broughton who was very nearly crazy on that terrible evening. His weird dinner party celebrating his wife's adultery made him angrier than ever.
I mean, she can go and live with him all she wants, but I'm not going to bloody well pay for it.
Let's go.
No, I want another drink.
Jock!
Come on.
After he'd left June, he set off in search of the lovers. He went first to the party they talked about and then anywhere else he could think of. Broughton finally caught up with the lovers here on the Ngong Nairobi Road. Busier now than in 1941. The sight of them together in flagrante delicto was too much for him. He pulled out a gun, the gun that he'd been so careful to report as stolen, and fired. With Errol dead, Broughton raised the gun and fired again. This bullet sliced through Diana's neck. She screamed. Somehow, her cry seemed to wake him out of his madness. What the hell had he done? He helped her out of the car, and they pushed it off the road into this very murram pit. Diana, ever the pragmatist, had no intention of facing the world as the widow of a hanged murderer. In fact, from that first terrible moment, she took over. She flew to Johannesburg to secure the best barrister that money could buy. She had to salvage what was left of her position.
What was your reaction on hearing the news of Lord Errol's death?
Well, I was dumbfounded.
Well, wasn't it a satisfactory solution to your domestic troubles?
Certainly not.
It's no solution at all. How is it no solution?
I can't think of any man who would relish the idea of resuming a marriage with a woman who had been and was still madly in love with another man.
But she'd need more than a good defense to get him off. If ruin were to be avoided,
Other methods would have to be employed. Somehow, notes taken at the scene of the crime vanished from the police records. June Carberry was persuaded to perjure and in the process ruin herself by giving Jock an all-night alibi, presumably because of her guilt at having wrecked his marriage by helping the lovers. Finally, Jock's friends managed to get his faithful barber selected as foreman of the jury. Oddly, the authorities seemed not to notice. Why? Well, in war, a divided nation is a weak nation, and the propagandists were working hard to unite the British high and low and bury any hint of a selfish and hedonistic upper class. How then were they to cope with adulterous earls and inebriate baronets, sex and violence beneath the tropical sun? The last image they needed as a rallying cry was a British aristocrat swinging at the end of a rope. The scheming worked and Broughton was acquitted. Much good did it do him. Diana soon left him and he returned to England a broken man. On the 5th of December 1942, he took his own life in the Adelphi Hotel, Liverpool. This is St. Paul's Church, Kiambu. And it was here that they buried Jos Errol, next to the grave of his almost equally tragic second wife, Molly. It was the end of his story. The others staggered on, drinking, dancing and divorcing. Predictably, perhaps, it was Diana who was the great survivor. She married twice more, ending up with Gladys's stepson and presiding over Kenyan society as the beautiful, mysterious Lady Delamere. As for the scar on her neck, well, she kept her hair long for the rest of her life. And if she put it up, she always wore a scarf. And what about Jock's barber, who played such a key role in his delivery? Well, history doesn't relate what his reward may have been, but Broughton certainly understood the debt. Just after his acquittal, he sent a telegram home to give them the news in England. Saved, it read, by a hair's breadth.